Welcome to the Naked Truth Report with your host, truth warrior and myth buster, Kathleen Wells. The place where we distinguish fact from fiction, where data is used to drive points home, and where Kathleen takes the position that Democrats and black politicians have destroyed black America. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report. Now, your host, Kathleen Wells.
Welcome. My truth warriors and myth busters. Yeah, it's me, truth warrior, your friendly truth warrior, Kathleen Wells, host of the Naked Truth Report. Hey, listen, folks, I want to wish you all a happy new year. You know, I wasn't here last Sunday because we played music. I hope some of you who listen enjoyed the music. And then the Sunday before that, what did I do? I also played Christmas music. So I haven't had an opportunity to say Happy New Year. We're in a new year. I'm excited. It looks like it's going to be a really, really exciting new year, politically at least anyway, right? Because there's so much going on already. I mean, gee, you know, one of the things that I was going to talk about was the fact that this book by Michael Wolff was written, and the lamestream media is what I like to call them. The lamestream media, I may have stolen that from someone. The lamestream media for the last couple of days, at least I know for sure, Washington Journal had a whole hour on the book. And what did I just find out? First of all, the author, Michael Wolff, conceded that it is like chock full of lies, falsehoods. It's not accurate. It's fiction. So the question I have for us, for you, for listeners, is why is the mainstream media focusing so heavily on something that isn't even accurate? Why? Why would they do that? I don't know. Does that make sense? But anyway, the latest news on this is, I'm not going to go into it a lot. I'm not going to go into it deeply because what? Guess what? WikiLeaks just downloaded the book. So, I mean, I don't think I'm going to read it. I may glance at it or something like that. I looked at it quickly. It's a PDF file downloaded by WikiLeaks on the internet. And I just glanced at it briefly, quickly. And one of the things, I think in the first or second paragraph, he said, well, you know, I had interviews with Trump. And Trump has already conceded that he spoke with him for 15 minutes or something like that. I mean, is that an interview? I don't think so. So already the book is like, you know, just in the first or second paragraph or whatever, I was just glancing. It's like inaccurate. And I remember when I was listening on Washington Journal, they were like, I mean, all these people were calling in and immediately, they particularly Democrats. And only Democrats. Because Trump supporters, people who voted for Trump, they don't buy it. They don't just jump on the latest, you know, latest charge against criticism or characterization against Trump, against the White House. We don't do it. This book, the quotes contained within the book, the Bannon quotes contained within the book, Trump supporters get tighter and unite. Tighter in favor of Trump. There's nothing that is going to make Trump supporters stop being for Trump. Nothing. Why is that? Because his policies are what we wanted him to, we embrace his policies. That's why we voted for him. It wasn't Russia that made us vote for Trump. It was Trump's policies. And the main policy that I talk about here on the Naked Truth Report is what? Illegal immigration. So one of the things that they say in the book is that, it was a quote that the whole White House, I mean, this was a quote, something 100% of the people in the White House thought that, you know, Trump was mentally unstable and childlike. So the question is, you know, if he's mentally unstable, he's an incompetent, he had help by Russia, oh, and he didn't really want to be president, but he was this man who is so incompetent and incapable was able to beat out Hillary Clinton, this experienced and seasoned politician with a war chest close to $1 billion. He's so incompetent. He had such help from Russia, and he didn't really want to be president, but he was able to beat out Hillary Clinton? Does that make sense? I don't think so. It doesn't reason. But getting back to Washington Journal, I watch Washington Journal sometimes, not all the time, not as much as I used to, because it's way too negative. It's like when it's mad day on Trump, mad day, here come the people calling in. Oh, Trump, he's an idiot. Oh, he's stupid. You know, it's just, he's a racist. He's a xenophobe. He's a this, it's a that. It's never substance. You know, and so when it's mad day on Trump, because they're talking about the Michael Wolff book that contains the quotes from Bannon, here it comes. Oh, yeah, I see. Remember, Bannon was the what, quote, white supremacist. So now Democrats believe a white supremacist over Trump. Oh, yeah, Bannon is now like, you know, giving the 411, bashing Trump, letting us know what's going down, telling the truth. He couldn't take it anymore. He's angry because he was fired, blah. This is what people, I mean, immediately Democrats just jump on anything that comes out that's negative about Trump. I don't care what it is. They just want to believe it. They don't even know why. Who cares? They just want to believe it. They want to just talk about them. They don't, you know, they don't care about the tax policy, the tax cuts. They don't care about immigration. Oh, I just read something that said that less than 5 years ago, 54 Democrat senators wanted funding for a Mexican, a border wall against Mexico. They wanted to get rid of diversity lottery. They wanted to get rid of chain migration. Less than 5 years ago, 54 Democrats in the Senate voted for that. But now that Trump is saying the same thing, it's like, oh my God, he's a xenophobe. Do you get what I'm saying? This is like ridiculous. But I did say Happy New Year. And you know what? I'm going to open up the phone lines. I said Happy New Year. I'm going to open up the phone lines in the second half of the hour because, you know, the Sunday before New Year's Eve, what did I do? I opened up the phone lines. I let people call in, and it was a good thing. I like hearing from people out there in Truth Warrior land and Mythbuster land. I like hearing from you. I want to know what you have to say. So I'm going to open up the phone lines again. Is it a good thing? Yes, I think so. So the phone number is 866-870-5752. That's 866-860-5752. And let's see, at the half hour, we're going to open up the phone lines. And you can call in and talk about anything you want to talk about. Yes, I'd like to hear from my truth warriors. Yes, I'd like to hear from my myth busters. I think it's good when you call in. I enjoyed it the last time. I want to continue to do this a little while longer. So let's see, what's the other thing I want to talk about? So we talked about the book is fictitious, it's irrelevant. It'll be, you know, no one will know about it, and we won't be talking about it in a few days. It's going to be done, finished, over with, right? Because pretty soon we're going to be talking about infrastructure, and that is a very important thing, getting infrastructure done. And in fact, there's a website that says, you know, the rating of infrastructure, the roads in Los Angeles, or in California rather, are rated D. Well, we all know that. We drive on them, right? And there's too many people driving on the roads. Well, the other thing that I wanted to talk about is what is the latest information that has come out regarding the Clinton Foundation? Are there are two things. They're the Clinton emails, the scandals, which is going to be, we just found out last week that they're going to be reinvestigated. Why, you ask? Why? Well, they should be. Because what did they disclose? They disclosed the draft letter that the FBI staff gave to Comey. And in those draft, there were five of them, I think. In those draft letters as to whether or not they should prosecute Hillary for her email scandal, they use words like grossly negligent, which is the standard in the statute, grossly negligent. I think that's the standard. Wait, let me see. Is it grossly negligent or is it recklessly? Let me look it up. I have it written down. But anyway, that's what the staffers for the FBI, they use the words that were contained within the statute, right? But when Comey actually got the letters that were written by the FBI staff folks, he took his red pen and inked out gross negligence and put in carelessly, she carelessly Oh, she used extreme carelessness. Now, the statute, the wording in the statute that would implicate liability, criminal liability, is gross negligence. And the staff members of the FBI used those words, gross negligence. Comey took his red pen, scratched it out, and put in careless negligence. In other words, the members of the staff, they drafted a letter that said that her behavior with her emails fit the definition, the characterization that would implicate criminal liability. But for some reason, Comey said, no, no, no. And these emails, these draft memos of Hillary's conduct regarding how she handled her personal servers and her emails was disclosed last week. Those FBI staffs drafted letters and gave them to Comey, and they contained the words contained in the statute, gross negligence. But instead, Comey scratched out gross negligence with his red pen and put in extreme carelessness. Those were the exact words. Then there was another section, and you saw, see, these drafts, I think the draft memos were disclosed by the inspector general. I don't know how they were disclosed, but we have now access to these draft memos. We've seen 5 draft memos. And in another one, they said that there was a good likelihood that Hillary's emails were accessed by foreign intelligence services. A good likelihood, a very good likelihood that Hillary's emails were accessed by foreign intelligence services, right? So what did Comey do? He got out his red pen again. He got out his red pen again, and he scratched out a very good likelihood, and instead he put in, what did he put in? Let me see. I'm looking it up. So here we that it was edited back to that it was possible. It was possible that foreign intelligence services had accessed her emails. It was possible. So you see here what Comey is doing. Comey was trying to, you know, massage his characterization of Hillary's behavior regarding her emails. He was trying to make it less, you know, less egregious, less criminally inclined, you know, so that, you know, she wouldn't be prosecuted. He was trying to save Hillary. You know, I think it was July 16th when he came, or sometime in July before the election, right before the election, he came out. And, you know, everyone, I remember that vividly. Everyone was sort of like sitting on their seats, sitting on the edge of their seats, thinking, oh my God, Hillary deleted 33,000 emails, used bleach bit to discard her emails, use a hammer to, like, you know, destroy these Blackberries. Everybody was like sitting on the edge of their seat thinking, oh my God, Hillary is getting ready to go to jail, right? Hillary is going to go to prison. That's what everyone was thinking. And so Comey used the word, like, you know, he didn't use gross negligence. He said it was extremely careless. Even extremely careless is sort of like gross negligence. Even, you know, gross negligence is the term used in the statute. But, you know, basically extreme carelessness is like gross negligence, right? So everyone's like, oh my God, she was grossly negligent. No, she was extremely careless. Oh, Hillary's going to prison. This is what people were thinking, right? And then he said, you know, it was, you know, very possible that intelligence foreign agencies had access her emails. Oh my God, people. Now, you know, the people who wrote the draft, the staff, the FBI staff members who wrote the draft said there was a very good likelihood that foreign intelligence services had accessed her email. You know, I mean, this is, do you understand what I'm saying? FBI officials, FBI staffer said there's a very good likelihood that foreign intelligence services accessed Hillary's emails. Hillary was our Secretary of State. And because she decided to have her personal server in the bathroom, her information is being accessed, very good possibility, by foreign intelligence services. Hello. It's like, what? You know, and when you listen to Alan Dershowitz talk about this on Fox News, which I've heard him speak about it quite often, he says that, you know, there shouldn't be criminal, you know, she shouldn't be held criminally liable. She shouldn't be. Why not? So the question I have for my listeners is this. Should anyone be above the law? Should anyone be above the law? Listen, if you're considering impeaching Trump, the president of the United States, that's saying he's not above the law, right? The Democrats want to impeach Trump. So they're saying Trump isn't above the law. But yet Alan Dershowitz is telling us that, Alan Dershowitz, he also says that Trump shouldn't be impeached. But there's nothing why Trump should be impeached. So that's out of the question. But the bottom line is Alan Dershowitz is saying, well, you know, Hillary shouldn't be prosecuted, even though, you know, the FBI said that her conduct regarding her emails was careless, extremely careless. That's what Comey said. He X'd it out. And then the FBI staffer said it was grossly negligent. And then they said there was very good likelihood that foreign intelligence services had access to her emails. And she should not be held responsible for that. So the question is this. Do American people think that some members who work in government, some government officials, should be above the law? That's the question I'm going to put out there. You guys can call in and talk to me about that. Oh, you know, and I want to talk about another thing. This is the other thing I want to bring up. Is that, let's see, in Arkansas, FBI officials that work for the U.S. Attorney's Office have opened up. This happened last week, too. FBI officials that work for the U.S. Attorney's Office have opened up the Clinton Foundation investigation. Okay, now let me say this. The reason why, I know my truth warriors and my myth busters know that I used to be liberal, right? And in fact, I voted for Bill Clinton. I was a Democrat. I voted one time for Obama. But once you start, you know, so I was in that matrix. I had never dug deep and done research on, like, the Arkansas Travelgate scandal and all that stuff that was going on in Arkansas before the Clintons even got to D.C. I never did that research. I never dug deep because I was a Democrat. And I was like, oh, my God, this is just dirt on Bill Clinton. I don't want to know. But once I said, you know, I cannot be for these Democrats anymore. I cannot do it after 1 year of voting for Obama in 2008 for the first term and having my radio show at KCAA in the Inland Empire and digging deep and getting more involved in politics. I said, there's no way I'm voting for Democrats anymore. Black people have voted, Black Americans have voted Democrat for 5 decades. Oh, you know, there's another. Let me just go back a bit and say this. Regarding the book, they say that Trump is incompetent, mentally unstable, not very intelligent. He's not very intelligent. And, you know, when Trump came out and spoke yesterday or today about being a genius, he is defending himself because he's being attacked. Anyone, you know, all these psychiatrists and all these, you know, talking heads will say, oh, you know, Trump is insecure because he says he's a genius. I think he is a genius. Because if someone is attacking you, you're going to defend yourself. That has nothing to do with who you are as a person, whether or not you're insecure or not. When people are attacking you, you will say, wait a minute, buddy, let me tell you something about my brain. Let me let you know how smart I am, right? if people are attacking you. Trump is being attacked by the entire lamestream media. Of course he's going to defend himself. He's going to say, wait a minute. He's trying to tell you, listen, folks, are you nuts? How can I be mentally unstable? I beat out 13 established Republicans. I beat out Hillary. How can I? I'm running this thing. You know, I got attacked. It's not even worth going into. But what I'm trying to say, I can understand him defending himself. Anyone would defend themselves. People defend themselves when they're being attacked. That's just the bottom line, right? People defend themselves unless they're a shrinking violet, right? People defend themselves when they're attacked. That's just the bottom line. But anyway, what was I saying? I forgot. I always do that. But anyway, what was I saying? Oh, I was questioning Trump. Oh, so this is the thing that I was going to say. Okay, this was the thing that I was going to say. If Democrats are so smart, if they're so smart, why do they not know that Democrats have destroyed Black America for the past 5 decades? If they are so smart, why don't they know that? All you gotta do is walk through any blue city and see the state of affairs where Black people live. That's all you gotta do. You don't even have to know the data. But I can tell you some data. One data point is like the average median wealth for Black Bostonians is $8. All you have to do is go down to Skid Row in Los Angeles and see that we have blocks and blocks and blocks and blocks and blocks of Black men living on Skid Row. All you have to do is, remember on my show, do you ever see, how many Black construction workers do you see working on a job? All you have to do is look at that. So if Democrats are so smart, oh, wait, what is the other data point? There's so many, let's see, it will take Black Americans, it will take the average Black family 228 years to catch up to the average white family. Right? That's a data point. What's another data point? During Jim Crow, Blacks had 87% two-parent families, two-parent households, and 40% of their businesses. After Jim Crow, what? Blacks only have 25% two-parent households and less than 7% of their businesses. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows that two-parent, everyone knows that the family is the most important institution in society, right? And everyone knows that Blacks no longer have two-parent households, right? Everyone knows that, what's the other one? Let's see. The other data point is 150 years after slavery, Blacks owned 0.5% of the wealth of this country. Fast forward to today, and what is it? Blacks own 0.5% of the wealth of this country. So let me tell you, and every time you say to Democrats, let me tell you, Democrat, Black Americans, Democrats have destroyed Black America in 5 decades. They're like, no, they didn't. If you are so smart, it is so obvious. It is so obvious. Are you just in your little, your little echo chamber or your little area that you don't observe society. You don't observe what's going on. But smart people are observant, aren't they? Aren't smart people observant? So if you are observant, if you're smart, you observe that you don't see that many Black folks anymore. Let's see. Detroit is destroyed. Detroit is destroyed. Oh, and the other data point. The highest unemployment in the nation Black men in Illinois have the highest unemployment in the nation. I know you liberals read this stuff, right? Yet Black folks have been voting Democrat for 5 decades. And you guys are so smart, you can't put that two and two together? This is what I want to ask you. Why can't you put two and two together? Black folks have been voting Democrat for 5 decades. And this is the state of affairs. Those data points that I just gave you are the state of affairs for Black America. Do you understand what I'm saying? And if you're smart, you can put those two and two together. If you haven't been able to put that two and two together, I'm wondering why you're talking about Donald Trump and whether or not he's mentally stable or intelligent or not. That's the question. Okay, so the other point that I didn't finish talking about is the Clinton Foundation. I mentioned that before, but I didn't finish it, right? So currently, I think as of last week, I'm not sure, don't quote me on that, but they have reopened the Clinton Foundation investigation. They have reopened the Clinton Foundation investigation. Now, this was opened before. It was opened before in 2016 when Loretta Lynch was the attorney general. But you know what? She caused it to be closed. They had to stop it. She stopped that, okay? So now they've reopened it. And in fact, they've already interviewed one witness. This is in Arkansas. Oh, so this is what I wanted to say, that when I started looking at, when I decided not to be a Democrat, I started trying to figure out who are these Democrats? Who is this Hillary Clinton who called Black folks super predators? So I started doing research. And I looked at like books like Clinton Cash, and I started looking at interviews that you could find on YouTube of people being interviewed in Arkansas about what had gone on. And I looked at interviews about Travelgate. I mean, the Clintons have been dirty and corrupt from day one. And the research is out there, but you gotta dig and do the research. You gotta spend a lot of time doing the research. Anyway, I hear the music. I want you guys to phone in and you can talk about anything you wanna talk about. There's the music. The phone number is 866-870-5752. I'm Kathleen Wells, your friendly truth warrior. This is the Naked Truth Report. And when we come back from the break, you can call in and talk about anything you want. It's 866-870-5752. Thanks.
Kathleen Wells, the host of the Naked Truth Report, wants to hear from you. Just like our borders, the phone lines, well, they're wide open. Call in at 866-870-KRLA.
That's 866-870-5752.
866-870-KRLA.
Welcome back. This is the Naked Truth Report. I'm your friendly truth warrior, Kathleen Wells. And we were just talking about what? We were talking about there's a new investigation that has been started. They reopened their investigation because they were investigating before the Clinton Foundation back in 2016. But Loretta Lynch, the attorney general at the time, she got that smashed. She got that closed. So they reopened this investigation. And this is a good thing. Because when you start digging into, as I said, I voted Democrat, right? And Trump is the first Republican I ever voted for. But I never dug deep and did the research to find out exactly who these Clintons are. And when you do the research, you see that they've been corrupt from day one. And, you know, Democrats don't do it because they take things for granted. I mean, not to mention that, you know, first of all, you know, listen, the Golden Globes are taking place right now, right? And they're all into the sexual harassment stuff. Not to mention that Bill Clinton was like having an affair with, first of all, Monica Lewinsky, that was going on in the White House. But even before that, He was having affairs the whole time. Some people, I think her name was Juanita Broadwick. Did I get that right name right? Some people said he was a sexual harasser, if not a rapist. That alone is a big deal, right? That alone is a big deal. Because look at now, oh, these women are so, the hypocritical nature of the Democratic Party leaves a lot to be desired. They're hypocrites. They've destroyed Black America, yet they're not smart enough to even know. They don't even know, despite the data, despite the evidence. Just go down the skid row and see what's down there. We've been voting Black Americans have been voting 5 decades for Democrats. And go down the skid row. I know a lot of you haven't been down there lately. Go down there and look. I went recently. I hadn't been in 30 years. Go down and see what's happening on skid. It's abhorrent. It's shameful. Okay, I have a call from Pamela. Hi, Pamela. You want to talk about Hillary Clinton? Hi, Pamela from Culver City. Hi.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Yes, I was born in Los Angeles and raised in Los Angeles, so I've seen changes over the years. But the thing about Hillary Clinton, I don't know if you remember, but when the investigation started on her a few years ago, mm-hmm. there was also a talk about this young Black reporter who got indicted because he accidentally took pictures of some top secret thing, and he was put in jail for 1 year, and also a general of the military, he got put into jail, or he got indicted because of some minor thing. He may have, you know, passed papers with some top secret information to his girlfriend, and he got indicted. Does that sound familiar?
Yeah, I don't know about the young Black reporter. I know that a naval guy who was involved, I can't remember, but he was inside of a, he was inside some security area, and he took a picture, and he was indicted. And I think Trump is going to pardon that guy.
Okay. Yeah, I remember there was also a Black guy who served, I think, 1 year for some minor infraction. He accidentally took pictures or something. But anyway, I want to tell the Democrats that I believe Hillary is the epitome of the white privileged class getting away with murder. Mm-hmm. And I mean that literally. And I usually don't like to talk that way, but though they talk about the privileged white class, and she's the epitome of one who's getting away with murder. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that she supported Margaret Sanger, and Margaret Sanger was a eugenist who wanted to get rid of the Black race, and Hillary Clinton received an award, a Margaret Sanger award. So that also shows that she doesn't really support the Black people.
Mm-hmm.
And also I talked to a Haitian who drove me from mm-hmm. LAX to my home from the airport,
mm-hmm.
and I asked him, you know, how has the Clinton Foundation helped Haiti?
Haiti,
he said it has not helped Haiti at all. The Clinton has only used Haiti for their agenda, but the Haitians do not like the Clintons at all.
Exactly. So, Pamela, that's the question that I put out there is to my truth warriors and myth busters, my listeners. I asked them, do you think that any government official should be above the law?
No, exactly. Not at all. Not especially when so many people who's done 1% of the stuff that she has done, and they have been indicted, they have served time. She should be thrown in jail for life for everything that she has done.
I'm glad you called in, Pamela. Thanks for listening. I agree with you 1,000%. Alan Dershowitz says that no government official, you know, he doesn't believe Trump should be impeached no matter what he's done. And, you know, unless I guess it rise to the level, I don't know what it would have to be. And he also doesn't believe Hillary Clinton should be indicted for any criminal offense. I want to ask my listeners, my next listener is David from Orange County. David, let me ask you, do you think that government officials, or specifically Hillary, should be above the law? Should she be indicted for this grossly negligent handling of emails? David, hi.
Hi, absolutely. And the thing is, I hope that the critical mass will get to that point in our present administration to where that happens and people come to their senses there and do that. It could happen, but we have to pressure them with phone calls to Congress. I want to ask the Democrats, if you're so smart, why is a California Democrat legislature so corrupt, so inept, and so self-interested that they are causing a dramatic increase in crime in California through their bill AB 109, their promotion of Prop 47 and 57, and the SB 54 Sanctuary City Bill? That Kevin DeLeon, he offered that bill and pushed it and falsely stated that Donald Trump's immigration policy is based on white supremacy. The problem is these people are so corrupt, they're willing to presently endanger our lives by what they're doing. This Kevin DeLeon and this whole California Democrat legislature need to be exposed by every single listener, every single person. In addition, this gas tax bill, it's just one thing after another. They've caused a dramatic increase in crime through those bills and Prop 47 pushing that. They could have campaigned against those. They legally can. Brown didn't campaign against legalization of marijuana. He campaigned for Prop 53. He could have opposed in ads against 64, legalization of marijuana, against Prop 57, but he didn't. This means that they're corrupt and they don't care about our well-being. They're endangering our lives, and they're lowering the qualities of our life to an unacceptable degree, and they need to go. We need to vote Republican. We need to get the right people in. These people are endangering our lives, and we have to pay attention and voice ourselves to the voter.
They're endangering our lives. They decrease the standard of living, the quality of life. You see our roads all the time. Our roads are D. You know, we're going to be taxed again for. In fact, I heard something about we're going to be taxed for, like, they're going to increase registration based on the value of your car, either between, you know, something you'll be paying an additional, I don't know how much, but I can't remember. And also, we're going to pay another tax based upon for transportation improvement or something like that. Did you hear about that?
I'm going to tell you what we can do about that. Oh, yeah. They violated the California Constitution by spending those last gas taxes on other things. Number one, for illegal alien benefits, for outrageous government employee salary increases and health benefits, for pay-for-play to union employees, government employees, so that those employees' unions could do ads, give these Democrats campaign contributions, do union pack ads against Republicans. It's corruption to the core, and we're paying for it. We don't have to. Here are three things you can do. Mm-hmm. Number one, I believe that gas tax repeal is going to be successful. Number two, there is a ballot initiative effort going to stop the end the open primary. You see, Democrat corrupt Chuck Schumer is using open primaries. He's promoting open primaries in states to defeat Republicans. And look what it's done for California. We don't have a voice. The top two Democrats, okay, get elected. But the problem is we're not given a fair voice. The Republicans aren't. So we need to end the open primary. Also, there's an effort by Mitch Englander. He's city councilman. He's pushing a ballot initiative to stop Prop 47, okay, and AB 109. So we all need to get on that. Fund that baby, okay? Fund that open primary ballot initiative. Get a hold of Tom. I have his contact information. I can call back next week for you about that. We need to end the open primary because they're destroying California, endangering our lives, your very life. You know that there is an epidemic now of in-home break-ins because of the Democrat legislature?
In-home break-ins?
Yes.
What do you mean?
Yes.
You know, yes. I know there's an epidemic of hit and runs. In fact, hit and runs have increased tremendously. In fact, a woman right down from where I live was killed, a mother, in front of her 14-year-old son.
Exactly.
Hit and runs have increased dramatically.
Because as Doug McIntyre said, now I saw this back in 2014. I saw on Channel 5 News, you can Google it, 14,000 hit and runs in 2014 alone. Doug McIntyre confirmed this too earlier this year in February. An article in Los Angeles Times about the increased traffic deaths in California, specifically in Southern California. Why? It's because Governor Brown gave 900,000 illegal aliens and increasing driver's licenses, and they're not trained. All they have to do is answer the questions on that test, and that's it. They're not trained. You notice how you get on that freeway anywhere in California, anywhere in Southern California, Nobody's letting you in when you put on your turn indicator.
I know. The driving has changed dramatically, hasn't it? They're very aggressive. And they're not, you know, the whole life's, everyone's so angry in Los Angeles. Have you noticed?
Yeah, and you know, this can change. We just need to organize and expose this to the voters. I told someone recently, and when I was with the eye doctor, ma'am, I told this Democrat union member, we got in a conversation. I told this lady how in May, when that recall against Josh Newman was going very successfully, suddenly the Democrat legislature came up with a corrupt idea to put an amendment in the budget bill to change the recall rules, to change the date of the recall from November to June, and also to give unlimited contributions to Josh Newman. They changed that rule, all to save their guy. Well, you know, that person's mouth dropped when I told her that. So we talk, we organize, we learn how to raise money and get our voice out there through PACs, starting political action committees, whereby we can get on the same level playing field with the unions and do our own ads and mailers against these Democrats.
Okay, so what is, you said, who is the person that people need to talk to regarding this open primary? You said his name is Tom. Is that his name?
Tom Palzer, P-A-L-Z-A-R. I can call you and get his phone number next week.
Yeah, I'd like to have him come on and talk. I'd like him to have him on the show. David, leave your phone number because his name is Tom Palzer. I'd like to have him come on the show. We need to do something and organize against this, right?
Yes, we do, and we can do it. All we have to do is expose to the, you know, a comment earlier this year, last year in February, that Jim, chairman of the Republican Party, Jim Brulte, California Republican Party chairman, said on air, if the voters knew what the voters were doing, they wouldn't vote for them. Mm. And Rush Limbaugh said, quote, the reason why the Democrats are winning in California is because there's not pushback. We need to push back to the voter, expose these corrupt, evil, literally, it's just plain outright evil what's going on.
I agree with you 1,000%. In fact, leave your number with my caller, Brooke, and I'm going to try and get, I'd like to get Tom Palzer on the line so we can talk about an open primary. Yes, the American people, the Los Angelinos must push back about what, and we can use my show to do that. My show can be a platform for Los Angelinos to push back against the corruption that is taking place in Los Angeles with this, and California with this sanctuary status. And in fact, you know, one of the reasons why I say this is evidence of why Martin Luther King has sold out black Americans in 1965. At the same time that the Civil Rights Act bill was passed in 1965, they also passed the Immigration Act of 1965. That's called the Hart-Celler Act. I want you folks to look at that. I know a lot of people don't know. But see, this was sort of like a hoodwink. This was sort of like a trick game, a con game that was played on the civil rights leader, including Martin Luther King and the black people. Because as soon as, here we do, the marching and the praying and the getting the water hoses and the dogs let on us, et cetera, and the marching and the praying and all that on and on and on, right? Years and years and years of fighting to get the civil rights of black Americans who are the direct descendants of slaves. As soon as we got that act, the Democrats also put immigrants on top of black. It's like they open up the floodgates. They open up the floodgates to immigrants to come into this country and to work, be as competitors to black Americans, basically relegating blacks back down to the second class position. Do you see? So it was sort of like a trick bag. Do you see what I'm saying? Because we didn't need that. We needed an opportunity to get ourselves on stable footing. Frederick Douglass, W. E. Du Bois, ever since the 1800s, they talk about how immigration impacts black America. This is the data point. For every 10% increase in immigration, black America loses 0.5% of their wealth. No, 1/3 of 1% of their wealth. For every 10% increase of immigration, black America loses 1/3 of 1% of their wealth. And there has been a 700% increase in immigration since the 70s. So you see how the whole Civil Rights Act was like a trick bag on Black Americans and on Martin Luther King. Okay, hi, Ernest from Los Angeles.
Yes, I would like to say that I believe, well, first of all, I'm a Democrat for Trump. And I voted for Trump because I believe he's going to reform the Republican Party. I don't believe that the Republican Party has been a pro-Black American at all, at least for the past 35 years.
Well, they don't have to be. We don't vote for them. Do you understand? Well, voting is quid pro quo. Republicans don't own Black folks anything. We don't vote for them. We vote Democrat 5 decades loyally. So it's Democrats who owe us. That's how voting works. It's quid pro quo. You get something for your vote. We don't vote for Republicans. They don't owe us anything.
Well, there are some Blacks in the Republican Party.
Blacks, 90% of more than 90% of Black Americans have voted Democrat for the past 5 decades.
Okay. All
right?
But now, what about Clarence Thomas?
What about him?
Do you know the history about Clarence Thomas?
What do you know about Clarence Thomas?
Well, I know that, in fact, I have, I could produce evidence to show that he was once director of the EEOC.
And?
And the EEOC, especially in Los Angeles, he made changes to the EEOC, so it is totally ineffective for Black Americans.
Well, how do you know that? So, in other words, Democrats have been effective?
Well, yeah, I guess you got me there.
I mean, that's the whole point. Actually, you should, go to my YouTube channel, the Naked Truth Report YouTube. And I do have I have all my archive shows there, right? And there's a show with Ted Hayes and also a show with Dr. Claude Anderson. I'd like you to listen to both those shows because, Republicans do owe us something, actually, to be honest with you. But it's not because we vote for them, because we don't. But they owe us something in the sense that Ted Hayes talks about this, and I can't remember the name of the case, but after, it's something like during Reconstruction or something like that, the Republican Party is the party that is supposed to look out for the welfare of the direct descendants of slaves. You and I, we are the direct descendants of slaves. The Republican Party is supposed to be looking out for us. And they've neglected that duty. And that duty was neglected during the Tilden Hayes Compromise. And Ted Hayes talks about that in one of my shows. You can go back and look. So they do owe us something. Ted Hayes would argue, and I understand that argument. But they don't owe us anything because we vote for them, because we don't vote for them. Do you know what I'm saying, Ernest?
Well, that could be. But again, I don't think I would say that to vote Republican. I did vote for Trump. Because I believe that he's going to form a reformed Republican Party.
Okay.
At least he has at least he's tried to establish an agenda for Black Americans.
Yeah, exactly. He mentioned that. Well, you're in Los Angeles, and I hope you. I'm so glad you voted for Trump, Ernest. I got to say that.
Well, I hope he proves out to what I think he will be.
And let's
otherwise, we're being wiped out of the state of California.
You know, that's right, right?
Yeah. And Los Angeles County is a good example also. Wiped out.
Where do you live, Ernest?
I live in Los Angeles.
But where, like, what area? You can
downtown,
tell me.
Downtown Los Angeles.
You live in downtown?
Yeah.
Do you see how Skid Row is down there?
Oh, yeah.
This is horrible.
And it's mostly Black Americans.
It's like 95% Black. And right next to Skid Row, you have the Fashion District, which is like Tijuana Revisited, right?
Yeah. And most of the businesses down here are owned and operated by foreigners.
Exactly. And I grew up in Los Angeles, and, I grew up in Los Angeles, so I know everything, right, about Los Angeles. I don't want to say my age, but I've been here a long time. And I used to drive all over and know everything. I know all parts of the city. That's what I'm trying to say, right? So, I mean, I've worked downtown, I've worked everywhere. And I hadn't been to Skid Row in probably 30 years, and I went down there recently, and I was absolutely shocked.
Yeah, it's a nightmare.
It's a nightmare. So that's why...
I've lived in two foreign countries. In fact, I lived in Mexico for about 2 years because I studied medicine down there.
And?
And I have not seen poverty to this level.
It's bad, folks.
Sitting down here at Skid Row.
It's bad.
I grew up in Los Angeles. It wasn't like this back in the 60s.
It was not like that. It was like maybe one block, if that. I don't remember. But now it's blocks and blocks and blocks and blocks of Skid. It's like Ted Hayes said, it's a neighborhood. And they're all black folks. And then right next to it in the Fashion District, you have Tijuana Revisited with black folks selling fashion. This is abhorrent. It's unacceptable. Thank you for calling in, Ernest. I really appreciate it. Don't forget to check out my YouTube channel, okay? Also, I'd like to tell listeners to subscribe to my YouTube channel. It's the Naked Truth Report. So you can go to YouTube, Google Naked Truth Report, and... subscribe to my channel, please. I encourage you. You know, we're going to get something done. I want to have, you know, I like what David said about Tom Pauser, I think his name was. I like what he said about him wanting an open primary. We're going to, you know, us here in California, we got to get a strategy. We got to fight back. We got to figure out what to do to change things. Because as long as these Democrats... Oh, this is the other thing I want to say. Do you realize that illegal immigration is the globalist agenda? It's the globalists. It's the globalists. It's the one percenters that want illegal immigration. Because it's suppressing wages, keeping folks poor. It's all... And another thing I want to mention is that I found out something about how veterans... are being neglected. Veterans. I only have 2 minutes. I'm going to talk about veterans next week. I think next week we're going to do another open phones. So anyone listening, next week we're going to have another open phones. You know, I'm going to let people call in and talk about anything they want to talk about. I like hearing from you guys. So next week we'll do another open phones. And next week I'm going to talk about veterans. I also want to put a call out there if there are any Los Angeles Unified School District teachers out there. I'd like to have some teachers come in and talk about how illegal immigration has impacted the Los Angeles Unified School District. So that's one thing. So here is my love song. Yes, I'm back after my vacation. Happy New Year. Here's my love song to Americans with deep roots and deep roots in America, to Los Angelinos with deep roots in Los Angeles, and Californians with deep roots in California. This is my love song to you. I love you, my truth warriors, my myth busters. I love you for having deep roots in America. We are Americans. Go American, go Trump. See you next week.
Be noblest.